Today we have Professor Liu Guoxie. He's a research fellow at the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, and he'll be talking to us about combating the three evils in China's counter-terrorism policies, with a particular focus on the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Our discussant for this particular session is Associate Professor Matthew Sussex. So we met Matthew a bit earlier. Matthew's research is largely in Russian foreign policy, Russian politics, but he has also done some work and research on the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. So he's really ready to get going with his discussant comments. And this is a session that will have a translation. Dr. Liu will be speaking in Mandarin, and Henry, the translator, will be translating for us. So when it comes to your questions, I'd probably ask that you've really thought about your question so we can keep it nice and tight, because the translation process will tend to delay the progress of the session. So without further ado, I'll turn over to Dr. Liu.
大家好，非常感谢ANU和麦克先生给我发的邀请。
I work in the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences.
我是从事国际政治和国际关系研究的，这些年来一直从事这个亚太区域合作。
I'm a researcher on
亚太区域合作
on the Asian Pacific cooperation.
这次来澳大利亚呢。 是我第一次来到ANU，也是第一次来到澳大利亚。
This is the first time that I visit Australia, and the first time I come to ANU.
也是第一次来到南半球。
It's my first time to come to a southern hemisphere.
来到之后呢，我发现，我们这个澳大利亚和我们中国啊，有很多地方不同。
I found Australia is very different from China.
比方说季节就不同。
For example, the weather, seasons.
道路行驶的规则也不同。And
the traffic rules very different.
所以我接下来的发言，我是不是担心我的思维跟大家也不太相同？
So I'm afraid that my logic might be a little bit different from everybody here.
好在呢，我们都是学者，有些问题呢，尽管有不同意见，我们可以坐下来交流。
Luckily, we are all scholars, so we can talk and discuss.
今天给我的题目呢，就是上海合作组织与中国的反恐。
Today, the topic I want to present is the Shanghai Cooperation Organization and counter-terrorism in China.
因为我现在我简单的介绍一下这个上海合作组织的一些基本的情况。
So let me introduce the Shanghai Cooperation Organization a little bit.
上海合作组织呢，它是哈萨克斯坦、中国、俄罗斯、吉尔吉斯斯坦、塔吉克斯坦，还有乌克兰，由这么六个国家组成的一个合作组织。
Shanghai Cooperation Organization was found by six countries: China, Russia, and China, Russia, Tajikistan.
2001年呢，它由在上海成立。
It was found in the 201 in Shanghai.
2015年的时候呢，印度和巴基斯坦又同时加入。
In 2015, India and Pakistan also joined this group.
那么到目前为止呢，它包括八个成员。
So far, it got four members.
四个观察员和六个伙伴对话伙伴关系。
Four observers and six dialogue partners.
那么这大家可以看出来，这个组织成立之前呢，它成立一个是上海五国机制，这个组织就是由上海五国机制衍生而来的。
We can see that the SCO is the further development of Shanghai Five.
那么从这几个国家呢，我们可以看出它是一个极具特征的、极具地域特征的一个区域组织。
This organization is a regional organization.
它成立以后啊，这大概这是今年是第16个年头，但是它得到了快速的发展。
Now it is just 16 years old, and it has been growing very fast since it was founded.
但是面临着这个恐怖主义的一些新的发展趋势呢，这个各个国家也都面，它这个组织也面临一些挑战，各个国家也正在研究。推出了自己的反恐措施，进一步深化合作。
Terrorism has present some threat to this country, so they the member states are working together to counter terrorism.
那么我下面要介绍一下这个上海合作组织的一些背景。
Now I want to talk a little bit about the historical background of Shanghai Cooperation Organization.
那么在上海合作组织成立之前呢，它有五年的机制运作期间。
Before it was officially founded, these countries have worked together for 5 years already.
那么这五年时间呢，这个上海合作五个合作机制呢，主要解决了三方面的问题。
We call them Shanghai Five.And at that time, they have solved three issues.
一个是紧急应对地区内存在的三股势力问题。
How to solve the three threats in the region?
也就是极端宗教主义、分裂主义和恐怖主义。
Terrorism and separatism and religions are extremism.
那么在这五年期间，他做了第二件事情呢，就是观念的互动。
And during that five years, they also they also do some communication among the members, and they exchange some views.
因为当时是正值冷战刚刚结束。
At that time, Cold War just finished.
我们和中亚国家之间和中俄之间都存在一些信任关系。
At that time, we need to enhance political mutual trust among the countries.
那么在这五年期间呢，这五个国家互相交流观念、思想产生互动。
During the 5 years that the five countries that work together.
最后呢，达成共识。
And then we reach agreement.
那么他这五年期间做了第三件事呢，就是增强互信。
During this period of time that we have enhanced our mutual trust.
这里面又包括两项重大的举措。
It included two things.
一个是裁军。
The first thing is to reduce the size of the armed force.
再一个是划定边界。
Another thing is to do the border demarcation.
这是这个组织健康发展以至于今天快速发展一个政治基础。
This is a foundation the foundation for the growth of the Shanghai Cooperation organization.
那么在这个期间呢，我们大家达成的共识就是都面临着同样的安全困境，有共同的政治合作意愿。
Because this country, all of this country had security issues, so we had the same political goals.
因为冷战刚结束的时候，苏联解体，中亚国家呢，就是独立出来了。
Because Cold War just ended and the Soviet Union collapsed, and many countries in this region get independent.
中亚国家出现了思想和文化的真空。
At that time, There is an ideology of vacuum in that region.
在这种情况下，三股势力乘虚而入。
So three threats arise.
在中亚地区呢，制造了很多这个恐怖事件。
So many terror attacks happened in this region.
与此同时呢，就是个冷战虽然结束了，但是冷战思维。在这个地区还是存在的。
Cold War has finished, but the thing is, Cold War mentality still exists.
西方的民主自由思想在这地区大规模的植入。
Western countries try to export democracy to the region.
嗯，再加上北约持续的东扩。
嗯。And NATO also tried to expand its territory to the eastern part of the Europe.
所以在这个地区呢，先后爆发了很多我们叫做颜色革命。
So color revolution happened frequently in the region.
在这种情况下呢，这三股势力活动就更加猖獗。
So because of this, three threat is getting more and more active and rampant.
并迅速地从原来这个阿富汗地区向中亚其他国家扩散，迅速地扩散。
And spread from Afghanistan to Central Asia.
那么各国政府都认识到了，要解决这个问题，光靠一国的努力是没有用的。
So many countries in this region realize it is impossible. It was impossible to solve the problem alone.
所以必须加强合作。
So they need to work together to cooperate.
那么第二个点呢，就是各国都面临紧迫的经济发展和社会转型问题。
This country had a problem with economic growth and social changes.
那么冷战结束之后啊，世界各地出现了很多区域化的发展势头。
After the end of the Cold War, regional cooperation has become a trend.
那个与西方国家发达国家相比呢，他们在科技发展水平和这个国内基础设施建设、制度建设方面，这个中亚国家。都严重落后。
Most SCO member countries are developing countries. They are lagging behind in technology, infrastructure, and social system.
同时，这些国家也面临从原来的计划经济向市场经济转型的问题。
And at the same time, this country also had some difficulty in transforming their planned economy into market economy.
在这个经济全球化和信息网络化的冲击下，这些问题非常紧迫。
In the age of globalization, this problem become very urgent.
因为不解决这两个问题，那么这些国家就永远落后于这个时代了。
If they didn't fix the problem, they will completely fall behind the rest of the world.
可以说，求安全谋发展，以发展促安全，是这些国家的一个普遍的心态。
So, maintaining security and pursuing a development have become a common goal among Central Asian countries.
那么第三个背景呢，就是这些国家呢，对出于对这个冷战后的国际关系的一个新型的一种思考，一种前途的思考。
The birth of the SCO is also offer a new perspective.On international relationships, after the end of the Cold War.
因为大家知道，中亚国家呢，就是领土都是相连的。
We know, all the Central Asian country, they are all what is that? They all join together.
他们都是昔日那个冷战体制的直接受害者。
All of them are victims of the Cold War.
在冷战期间长达半个世纪呢，他们经济发展都严重落后。
During the Cold War, that they did not make too much progress in the development of politics and economy.
那么今天冷战结束了，这个以后的国际关系、国际格局怎么发展，是他们要面对的问题。
But what is their next step after the Cold War finish? Yeah, they have to think about this issue.
很显然，这些国家都不愿意重走冷战那个老路。
It was very obvious that they didn't want to return to Cold War.
那么，既然不走那条老路，又有什么新的道路可以走呢？只有合作。
So because they don't want to return to Cold War period, so what should they do? They had to cooperate.
那么就是在这种情况下呢，那个成立了上海五国和那个会晤机制。
So yeah, because of this, they have Shanghai Five mechanism.
就是中俄哈基塔。
China, Russia, and Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan.
Yeah. 五个国家。 那么在这个五国恢复机制运作了五年之后呢，那么在乌兹别克斯坦又加入了。5 years later,
another country, Uzbekistan, also joined the group.
那么在这种情况下，我们就不能再叫五国了，所以就成立了上海合作组织。So
we established Shanghai Cooperation Organization.
同时签署了上海合作组织成立宣言。
And so we signed the Declaration of Shanghai Cooperation Organization.
那么在这种从此之后呢, 上海合作组织才进入了一个快速的发展阶段。
So after that, the SCO grew very fast.
那么上海合作组织由五个国家, 变成六个国家, 完了之后现在又变成八个国家。
Okay, now it got now the member states increased. Now we have 8 member states.
那么我再介绍一下我们中国是怎么出于什么考虑加入这个上海合作组织。
Now I want to talk a little bit about why China joined this group.
大家可能也都知道，上海合作组织成立以后啊，中国表现非常积极。
Everybody knows that after SCO was founded, China has been very active in the group.
它不仅是积极的参与者和建设者，在人力、物力、财力方面也给予很大的支持。
Chinese government also make a great contribution in finance, resources, and manpower.
五国会晤机制和上海合作组织成立这个会首次会议都是在中国上海召开。
The summits of Shanghai Five were hosted in China, and the first meeting of the SCO was also held in China.
所以这个组织叫上海合作组织。So
this group is called the Shanghai Cooperation Organization.
它的秘书处也设在北京。Its
headquarters is located in Beijing.
首任秘书长也是由我们外交部副部长兼任。The
first secretary general is Deputy Foreign Minister of China.
那么中国为什么在这个上海合作组织当中倾注这么多的精力？
Why did China put so much effort for this group?
我想啊，主要是三方面的原因。
Because we have 3 considerations.
一是我们国内政策上的一些考虑。
From the perspective of domestic policy.
刚才说冷战结束之后，我们中国西部也面临着一些恐怖主义这个威胁。After
the Cold War ended, terrorism present a big threat to the western part of China.
还有呢，就是当时成立过五国机制这个时候呢，我们的改革开放已经进行了20年。
When Shanghai Five was established, China has launched its open door policy for 20 years.
那么接下来呢，就是我们中国就发展上就出现了很多问题，比方说东西部发展不平衡。So
China also faced some problems, like a regional imbalance in economic growth.
从90年代初开始，我们中国政府就酝酿怎么样来这个通过这个西部大开发，把东部的资源、经济资源向西部转移，带动西部发展。Since
early 1990s, Chinese government has planning to transfer some of its energy to the western part of China.
但是呢，正如西部呢存在着一些治安、恐怖主义这些隐患。But
because terrorism in the western China.
所以很多这个企业啊、人员呐、等经济要素啊，不愿意向西部流动。So
many private enterprises, many private companies, were reluctant to invest in Western China.
那么中亚中国西部和中亚的国家呢有紧密相连，人员文化相同，宗教信仰相同，所以他们往来频繁，恐怖主义也是在这个时候蔓延到中国新疆啊，中亚整个中亚地区。
But because the Western China is very close to Central Asia, so terrorism spread in those regions.
所以要控制新疆这块这个恐怖主义，我们也必须跟中亚国家进行合作。
So in order to deter terrorism in Xinjiang, we had to work closely with Central Asia.
那么第二呢，我们是从地缘政治上考虑的。
The second consideration is from the geopolitical perspective.
中国改革开放以后呢，我们一个外交政策的一个根本的出发点就是塑造良好的周边安全环境。
Since the Chinese economic reform, the ultimate goal of Chinese foreign policy is to create a very friendly environment for the modernization of China.
但是大家也都知道，中国的东部这个安全环境呢，并不太理想。
But China got some problem in eastern part.
中日之间有钓鱼岛问题，中那个还有南海问题，还有朝鲜半岛问题，还有台湾问题。
The relationship between Japan and China doesn't look good, and Taiwan issue and South China Sea disputes are all problematic.
那么在这种情况下，在东部环境得不到改善的情况下，我们希望西部和北部是稳定的。
Also, Beijing has to make sure the situation in eastern China will not get worse when it is trying to maintain the social order in the northwest China.
所以呢，苏联解体之后呢，我们跟中亚国家之间的合作提供了一个机会。
So this is an opportunity for China to work with Central Asian countries.
那么第三点呢，我们是从区域经济和全球经济上考虑的。
The another consideration is from the perspective of regional economic growth and global economic growth.
如果大家回顾一下，可以知道，冷战结束之后呢，欧洲国家出现了通过马斯赫里特条约成立了欧盟。
After the Cold War, a European Union was created.
那么亚太地区呢？当时是那个澳大利亚的总理啊，叫霍克，还有马哈蒂尔等倡议下呢，成立了亚太区域合作组织。
At that time in the Asian region, Asia Pacific,
亚太合作组织。
区域合作组亚太区域合作 APEC
APEC also founded
而中亚地区呢，这个地方由发展中国家构成的，如果说这个欧洲这个是个发达的经济体，这面是一个新兴的经济体，大家都认为是冷战后发展最快的最有潜力的一个经济体。
Europe was doing very well, and Asia Pacific is also considered a new engine for global economic growth.
那么这两大经济体要是想联系起来，离开中国是不行的。
So China is geographically advantage in connecting to economic zone.
而恰恰就是这个地带呢，我们称为塌陷地带。
The people call the Central Asia is a lacking region.
全球的经济要素就因为这个塌陷地带很难发生联系。
Because of Central Asia, so the world, the global economy, it's very difficult to grow.
所以呢，出于对自身中国自身的考虑和全球经济这个考虑，中国决定加强促成上海合作组织这个合作。
For the sake of Chinese economic growth and for the sake of the future of global economy, China have decided to cooperate with country in Central Asia.
那么我第三部分呢，我想讲一下上海合作组织这个机制建设与合作领域。
I also talk a little bit about the organizational structure and the cooperation field.
那么大家也都知道，现在上海合作组织已经成为一个区域合作发展的一个典范。
It has become a good model of international organization.
包括我们今天这个会议，大家也都知道，就是很多全球性的一些研究机构都在研究它。
Many research institute have been studying this organization. Yeah.
它这个发展主要体现在三个方面。
它的发展
快速发展，它的快速发展体现在三个方面。
Okay. The SCO has been growing very fast since it was born. This can be proved from three perspectives.
也就是它的机制建设和合作领域以及现在在国际上的一些影响。
The organizational structure and cooperation project and its international influence.
那么在机制建设方面呢，上海合作组织现在可以说是一个非常成型的合作组织。
Its structure has become more and more complex and complete.
它有很多机制，比方说元首理事会，政府首脑理事会，还有这个部长级会议，这是政府层面的。
Okay. It has the Council of Head of State, the Council of Head of Government, and the Council of Foreign Minister.
还有一些非政府层面的，就比方说实业家协会、银行联合体啊，还有这个组织论坛呢、啊，一些非官方的一些机构。
Besides, SCO also created a framework to promote non-governmental cooperation, such as the SCO Business Council, SCO Interbank Consortium, SCO Forum.
尤其它的常设机构，秘书处和地区反恐中心、反恐机构，在打击恐怖主义方面发挥了非常重要的作用。
Also, its counter-terrorism organ also make a great contribution in counter-terrorism.
那么是第二方面呢，就是它的合作领域在不断的在扩大。
SCO member country also keep increasing their cooperation project.
这里面呢，安全合作是个核心。
Security issues, the cooperation in security issue is the most important thing.
安全问题这个发展呢，是原来由应急性的打击恐怖主义三股势力，那么现在发展到了传统、非传统，整个安全领域。
OK, 传统跟
非传统。
传统跟非传统，我不知道你的意思啊。
非传统是怎么说
？Non-traditional. We have two approaches. One is
比方说经济安全、粮食安全、气候环境，这属于非传统。
Now the way we cooperate is very comprehensive. We use traditional method and non-traditional method.
这里边成就最大的应该说是经济合作。
The greatest achievement we have got is the cooperation in economy.
上海合作组织刚成立的时候是2001年。我们跟中亚国家之间的那个贸易额120亿美元。
When the SCO was founded, the trade volume between China and Central Asia just $12 billion.
到2015年的时候是1300多亿美元。
Okay, in 2015, now is 130 billion US dollars. Yes.
经济合作这个领域包括投资啊、金融啊、税收啊、交通、能源、农业，这都属于经济合作。
Including the taxation, agriculture, and so on.
还有一个就是教育合作。
And also we have done something. Cooperation in education. Yes.
在那个普京总统的那个倡议下，上海合作组织要建立一个上海合作组织大学，他当时是这么提议的。后来呢，这个大学就是建立一个松散的，就是把各个国家，顶尖的大学各拿出几所。
Originally, a Russian president, he proposed that, we should establish a university for this group. But in the end, we decided to just choose some university for the project, for the cooperation project.
上海合作组织当时现在是六个成员，一共拿出62所高等院校参与为上海合作组织培养学生。
So 62 university in the region have joined this cooperation project.
还有就是国际司法合作，我们在上海政法学院建立了专门为各国司法人员提供培训这么个地方。
So we established a training center in Shanghai University of Political Science and Law.
那么这些合作一个前提就是政治合作。
The foundation of this cooperation project is political cooperation.
不仅是各个国家要直接要建立互信。 还要在国际场合以上海合作组织的名义共同相互支持，包括在联合国。
So we have to enhance our cooperation in politics. Yeah.
那么它的发展呢，还体现在这个国际影响力不断在提升。
Now the XUAR has become more and more influential in international society.
这个我刚才说了哈，有5个到6个到8个，到现在那么包括对话伙伴国和观察员在内，一共是那些人。Okay.
The number of member states continuously increased.
我来这之前呢，我还有幸还见到了那个现任那个上海合作组织的秘书长巴里莫夫。Okay.
你来之前吗？就在我这来之前，7月份。你在欧洲吗？
我在北京见的。Okay.
Oh, before I visit Australia, yeah, I was very lucky to meet the Secretary General of Khan, the Khan Secretary General of the SEO.
据他讲呢，现在还有9个国家要加入上海合作组织。
He told me, another 9 countries want to join the group.
我们掌握的有乌克兰、埃及、以色列，还包括美国。
Okay. Ukrainian, Egypt, even including United States.
还有另外5个呢，他说什么也不告诉我。
Another 5 countries, he refused to tell me.
除了这个跟这个国家之外呢，那个上海合作组织和独联体集体安全条约组织，联合国都建立了一种稳定的合作关系。
Besides individual countries, the XUAR also cooperate with other international organizations.
这是我们看到它的发展的路径。那么下面我要介绍一下，就上海合作组织，为什么发展这么快，它的原因在哪里？
Now, why is the XUAR growing so fast?
首先，我想啊，它这个这里边一个是思想问题，就是各国都有开展合作的共同的意愿。
Because all these countries have the same philosophy and the same need for international cooperation.
这是显而易见的，因为这个三股势力和恐怖主义啊，在这个这些国家这个地区啊，肆虐，长期肆虐。
This is because the three threats, especially terrorism, have present a big threat to the region.
那么联合反恐、共同打击呢，是各这些国家的一个共同的心愿。
So we have to work together and to take a joint action to deter terrorism.
第二点呢，就是上海合作组啊，它有一个比较好的合作原则，有合作模式。
The SCO has created a better cooperation model and principle.
在上海合作组织这个成立的宣言中啊。 就列了9条，这9条呢，我就不念了。Okay,
we have the philosophy of the SCO is Shanghai spirit.
总的来说呢，就是互信、互利、平等、协商、尊重多样化文明、共同发展。This
is based on the principles of mutual trust and mutual benefit and equal rights, negotiation and mutual respect, and joint development.
那么这一条呢，我们当时就把它作为叫做上海精神。We
call this principle Shanghai spirit.
第三点呢，就是 上海合作组织开展的合作路径比较特殊。
And the way we cooperate is a little bit unique.
我本人是研究亚太区域合作的，那么我这些年十几年了，将近二十年了，我一直研究亚太区域各个组织之间这个发展的路径问题。
I'm a specialist on the Asia Pacific cooperation. Yeah, so I have been looking at how people cooperate for decades.
那么亚太地区很多国际组织，它是都是从因为缺少互信，它都是从经济合作开始，到政治论坛，现在也是完了到全面的合作。现在这个地方就很难就进行下去，是吧？那个上海合作组织呢，它是从安全问题入手，安全合作到政治合作到全面合作。
When countries began to cooperate, they usually start with cooperation in economy, but SCO is different. We start from security issues.
我们看到今天亚太很多区域组织合作来合作去，那么经济合作发展很快，但是一涉及政治安全就停止了。
Nowadays, when people cooperate, when countries cooperate, they can start from the economy. But when they talk about the politics or security, they stop to cooperate.
但是上海合作组织不是，它是一个安全合作到政治合作，现在到全面合作，经济、教育、司法。
But the starting point of the SCO is security issue.
下面我要讲一下他当前面临的一些问题。
Now I want to talk about the major issues that SCO need to tackle at the moment.
他虽然取得了很多成绩，但是现在呢，也面临一些新的问题。
Now it is facing some problem now.
一个是他的自身能力建设问题。
The first one is it need to improve its own ability.
这是跟当前恐怖主义出现了一些新的发展态势很有关系。
This is because the pattern of terrorism.
在区域合作和这个电子支付国家之间的电子支付啊，金融结算啊，在这些全球化的这个大潮下，这恐怖主义也在向全球蔓延。
Okay. Because the e-commerce and the internet banking, so the terrorism also spread to.Every part of the world.
那么作为一个区域性的组织，要想解决这么全球性的问题，显然它能力是有限的。
As a regional organization, what SCO can do is very limited.
与此同时呢，它还要涉及跟这个其他国际组织机制的协调问题。
Another issue is the SCO need to cooperate with other international organizations.
很显然跟只由他自己一个区域组织是很难完成全球性任务。
Because SCO cannot cope, cannot deal with some problems alone.
第三呢，就是处理有关国家，特别是大国、地区大国和全球性大国的关系问题。
Also, SCO need to deal with relation with other powers.
恐怖主义诞生，大家也都知道，它中亚地区原来就是存在一些民族矛盾呐、宗教矛盾呐、还有这个教派之间的矛盾。
We all know there are some conflict in Central Asia, like in religion, politics.
它不仅善于制造矛盾，也善于利用矛盾。
These threats are very good at taking advantage of conflict.
在大国关系当中。尤其是大国之间对恐怖主义的定义啊、看法啊、这个派别啊，不持不同立场的时候，那他充分地利用了这个矛盾。
But the thing is, some major powers they have different views on terrorism. How to define terrorism? They have different views.
我们都看到，就是在叙利亚、阿富汗等问题上，美国、俄罗斯、叙利亚这个沙特啊、伊朗啊这些国家在中东地区这种较量和这个。大家都看到这一点。
We can see the United States and Russia and some major powers. They play different role in Syria and Afghanistan.
所以在如何认识恐怖主义这个问题上，我们这个上海合作组织显然还有很多道路要走。 如何认识恐怖主义？
认识，我不晓得认识的意思。
如何判定
？OK， 对。So how to define terrorism that accurately？ I mean, how to reach what is that？ We still have a long way to go to reach the what is that the agreement with other major powers。
现在我们也欣喜地看到，有很多国家呢，这个对恐怖主义这个观念啊，这个看法啊，都趋同了。包括我来之前，7月13号，英国政府就把这个东土耳其伊斯兰党就列为恐怖主义组织了。这个原来它是不是的
？OK， Before I came to Australia, that the British Home Office has listed Turkestan.Islamic Party as an Islamic terrorist group. This is a good thing.
下面我要介绍一下我们中国的那个反恐措施。
Now I want to talk a little bit about the China's counter-terrorism measure under the framework of the SCO.
我就快点说了，这个时间有点。第一呢，是我们参加上海合作组织这个联合反恐，共同打击震慑恐怖主义活动。
Okay, now we work closely with the SCO member, and we take joint action to deter terrorism.
上海合作组织成立以来呢，我们一共举行了13次的大规模的那个反恐演习。
Since the birth of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, China and the SCO countries have launched joint exercises 13 times.
那么这十三次当中呢，有7次就是在中国境内进行的。
But 7 of them were hosted in China.
在演习过程当中，中国不仅在这个人力、物力、财力，还后勤保障上，我们都提供了大力的支持。
And Chinese government always give full support in manpower, finance, resources, and logistics.
另外呢，我们反恐啊，更是注重从根本上解决恐怖主义问题。主要是通过开展区域合作来提高综合反恐能力。
We have a partnership with SCO countries in various fields, so we try to strengthen the SCO counter-terrorism ability.
第三呢，就是在我们国内啊，建立各个层级的反恐体系。我们是。确保一方平安，不向中亚国家输入恐怖主义，这是我们的一个原则。
Now we build a new intelligence system to fight the terrorism. We want to make sure the homeland is safe and secure.
那么几年来，我们在国家层面，各个省市都建了专门的反恐机构。
Okay, all the level of governments that we have some.The counter-terrorism office.
比方说，猎鹰，蓝箭突击队、猎鹰突击队，还有这个就是咱们封面，这是公安系统的建立的这个反恐部队。
We have some troops, some special forces to deal with terrorism.
第二点呢，我们是有。除此之外呢，我们还开展大规模的群众性运动。
We also continue a mass line campaign.
你比方说在北京，大家都随处可以看到一些老年人在街上巡逻。
We include all the members in the society into this system.
对，还有一个就是在这个新疆少数民族地区啊，我们开展去极端化的教育。
We also start a de-radicalization program in Xinjiang.
从娃娃开始，我们就是教育他，就是这个恐怖主义、伊斯兰教的本意是什么？我自己就跟那个戴维先生，我也研究这个。我们新疆的这个伊斯兰教啊，它属于皈依性的皈依穆斯林。
Also, we put a lot of efforts in local education of Xinjiang.
但是现在新疆人很难知道，很少有知道这段历史的。
But the thing is, we found the people in Xinjiang are not did not know their own history very well.
还有一项措施大家也都知道了，我们正在推进一带一路建设，发展西部经济。
Everybody knows that we are doing the Belt and the Road Initiative.
还有呢，就是我们在加强国际反恐合作，在国内呢，提那个加强那个反腐，也开展了国际司法合作，开展海外猎狐行动。因为我们为什么把这个海外猎狐和这个反恐联系在一起呢？因为确实我们从资料大量信息了解到 IS 的很多这个资金来源不明。
Now we also combine the anti-corruption with counter-terrorism.
所以我们现在很难掌握，就我们国内这个政府这个贪污官员呢跑到国外之后，他的资金的去向问题。
Now we try to trace the corruption problem.
总之，我们可以看到我们这个反恐措施啊，有这么个特点：一个是应急性的和战略性的相结合，那个打击和防范相结合，还有这个政治和经济手段相结合，国内政策和国外和这个国际合作相结合。这是我的今天的结论。
Okay, now the measures that we take to fight terrorism is we combine the urgent measures and the ongoing measures, and we also combine the politics and economy, and combine the domestic policies and international cooperation. Yeah, this is my conclusion.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for a very interesting paper. So I now invite Matthew to come up and give his response as discussant.
Thanks very much. And I'd like to particularly thank Dr. Wu for his excellent perspective on the evolution of the SCO and the challenges that it faces. I should note at the outset that I'm somewhat at a disadvantage in that I'm having to rely a little bit from Dr. Liu's translated paper from Google Translate. So I hope our Chinese guests and anyone in the room who has much better language skills than I do will forgive me any egregious misinterpretations that I might make. I think Dr. Liu's paper is quite commendable for a number of reasons, chief of which are his focus on the interplay between domestic factors, geopolitical factors, and the economic drivers behind the SCO's evolution. Second, I think he's correct to identify the need for coordinated and, flexible responses by defense personnel across nations, and this came out in the written version of his paper, as well as the use of social inclusion programs to try and prevent radicalization, and also working with regional bodies on cooperation. And I think this is consistent with China's approach to the three evils, and also consistent broadly with many SCO members' interests. But I do think one thing we need to consider is whether the motives and the rationales of different members within the SCO can always be viewed as mutually reinforcing. And I think that because interests in respect to counterterrorism are quite vulnerable to being subsumed by perhaps broader strategic considerations, there is still the possibility for misunderstanding and even security competition to emerge in the SCO space, both as it is now and especially when it expands in 2017 to encompass India and Pakistan as well. So in my remarks, I'd like to adopt a kind of broader geostrategic approach or lens to consider the question, is the SCO the right or useful organization to manage counterterrorism planning and responses in Central Asia and increasingly in South Asia as well? Now, I noted in an earlier session that dealing with the types of security dilemmas that China has to face now was a kind of inevitable product of its upward trajectory. And I think that logic does hold in a kind of general sense. But that said, it doesn't say very much about the prospects for great power competition, the potential for spoiler roles by South Asian states who have completely different perspectives on what constitutes a terrorist or a freedom fighter, And what good management of these types of challenges might actually look like, not just by China, but by other member states of the SCO as well. Now, I don't think it's possible to answer a question about whether the SCO is the right organization without first asking, really, what is the SCO? And I think in the West, we often have a kind of cartoonish view of the SCO. Much of the literature on the topic, at least in the early years, hasn't been very, very helpful. Now, let me give you some examples of this. One view, and I should hasten to say that this is not a view I endorse, but one view is that the SCO has been a club for dictators. And under this formulation, it's effectively a way for Central Asian despots to gain strategic confidence in their position between Russia and China, and at the same time, some kind of personal confidence that they will receive insurance against rose, tulip, orange, other colour revolutions. That view, I think, is wrong because it puts Central Asia more or less in the driver's seat within the SCO. And there are much more pragmatic reasons for cooperation and mutual benefit that do go well beyond sort of political orientation. So a second view at the other end of the spectrum is that the SCO is a vehicle for Sino-Russian cooperation, or bilateral cooperation, under the guise of minilateralism. And although I think this had some truth to it initially, given that the core reason that brought the Shanghai Five together was indeed a security problem, the resolution of border disputes, I don't think we can say this logic holds much longer in a much more expanded, much more diverse SCO. Third view is that the SCO is China's laboratory. In other words, it's a place for China to test out various ways to manage regional order in its own backyard. Again, I think this view gives a bit too much significance to just one actor within the SCO, and it doesn't really reflect the range of activities that it's become engaged in. So, in addition to pointing to the need for more nuanced Western scholarship on the SCO, I think there's a more general need for assessments of what types of cooperation the SCO might be suited to. And here I think counterterrorism is perhaps a useful case study. Now, in my own previous work on the SCO, I've looked at it as a type of regime. Now, you might think that odd, not so much because regimes produce notionally nested institutions that reinforce cooperation, but more because regime theory is more usually applied to Western liberal democracies, seem to be an easier fit. But I have argued that the SCO does bear the hallmarks of a sort of nascent security regime, one that, if the current trajectory continues, may well potentially be a kind of hegemonic regime that China may wish to activate in the future. But of course, that isn't the case yet. Most of you will know that there was a tussle, a difference of opinion between Moscow and Beijing on precisely what the SCO should be. Moscow wanted it as an Asian NATO, as a military security organization. China wanted it as an energy trading club. And I think in the last 4 years or so, it's been fairly clear that Chinese preferences have won out in terms of framing what the SCO is. And here also I'd echo Andrew Small's analysis that Beijing has been concerned primarily with energy deals across the SCO membership region and trade routes second. But in terms of counterterrorism cooperation, I think there has been slow but incremental evolution. The regional anti-terrorism structure, or RATS, within the SCO initially seemed not so much concerned about managing terrorism, but to do with the more fundamental question of can Russia and China work together in a military sense, in terms of mutual exercises. But that is changing. It's changing and it's also becoming more urgent, particularly because of China's AFPAC dilemma, which we've talked about previously at this conference, as well as the policy posture of its new members. I think it is safe to say that on China's northern flank, it's more or less allowed Russia to take the leading role on counterterrorism through the auspices of the CSTO, the Collective Security Treaty Organization. And there's the reason for that is a coincidence of interest. On the one hand, Moscow's desire to ensure that it has a stable geopolitical buffer zone. And on the other hand, China's willingness to shift the security burden onto Moscow while engaging at the same time in trade and investment opportunities within the Central Asian region. But I think partly because of the success and the growth of activities within the SCO, you do have to wonder whether economic factors might begin to start driving broader insecurities, particularly on the Russian side. If they do, then counterterrorism cooperation within the SCO actually becomes much more important. And that's particularly the case because the CSTO, over on the Russian side, has proven itself too slow, too poorly funded, and really too divided to perform those types of tasks really effectively. So, is the SCO an appropriate organization to coordinate counterterrorism efforts? My answer is maybe. I've said absolutely nothing about the United States. I've said very little, or actually no, I said absolutely nothing. I was going to say something, but I've said absolutely nothing about the European Union. But I think those, as well as Indian and Pakistani membership, will constitute a number of pull factors that will start to impel China to look at regional organizations like the SCO to advance and safeguard their interests in the field of particularly counterterrorism. And the reason for that is because the optics of multilateralism are preferable, and multilateralism can be less costly than bilateralism. At the same time, of course, China's desire to become very deeply embedded in terms of trade routes, but also energy, through One Belt, One Road, will deliver the kind of push factors. But of course, China will need to be wary of institutional dilution that may well occur from having new members come into the same organization. So let me end then these observations, random as they are, with a kind of third question. And that is the SCO ready to take a leading role on counterterrorism in a broader regional sense? In other words, I hope this might engage our Chinese guests into the discussion. I'd ask, is China happy with the SCO? And what does it see as its future priority tasks to perform some of the roles that it needs to in future? Thank you very much.
Okay, so thank you for that response, Matthew. During Dr. Liu's talk, I thought we'd come back to that problem again about definitions. So I was thinking of your paper, Sean, and the problem with definitions related to terrorism and different ideas about what constitutes terrorism. So that was interesting. And I think you end with a very good question, too, to get our discussion happening. So I open the floor to questions.
Green Jarosh, National Security College. Doctor, if the SCO model was successful in enhancing conventional and unconventional security with neighbouring states, has this had the effect of reducing, increasing, or making no difference to terrorism?
Now
I answer your question.
SCO 就是上海合作组织，它下一步发展，我刚才也讲了，它确实面临着很多这个难题。
The next step for the SCO, I mean the SCO is facing many problems. Yeah.
除了这个。它的自身能力建设之外，还涉及跟这个国际组织协调和大国关系，尤其还是你刚才说的跟那个传统和非传统做的影响，是吧？
Yeah, we have some problems, like self-improvement and the relationship with other international organizations and countries. Yeah.
嗯。
然后。
特别是我们在推进这个上海和区域合作组织这个综合性反恐的合作，比如包括经济啊、政治、能源这个合作的进程当中，
嗯，
我们推进上海合作组深化和反恐合作。
嗯 ，OK，
嗯，这个过程中，
In our process of counter-terrorism。
我们在推进那个上海合作组织合作当中确实面临很多挑战，
嗯
嗯，包括就是这个与周边国家的一些关系。
We got some problem with the relationship with other countries, yes.
比方说这个北约吧，在我们推进一带一路建设的过程中，那么显然我们是绕不过北约。
When we are doing our project, One Belt and One Road, yeah, we can't compete with NATO.
除此之外呢，还有一些大国，比方说我们在推进一带一路建设当中，我们现在都看到了，有人说我们是在搞马歇尔计划，有的说是我们在搞那个珍珠链计划，是吧？就是珍珠链，就是就在环那个南太平洋到欧洲这块一个链条，
对，
就是这么个发展方式，就是传统的地区政治安全观。
Some major powers say that China is doing a Chinese version of Marshall Plan.
所以在我们推进"一带一路"建设，我们推进"一带一路"建设实际上也是综合反恐的一部分。
When we are doing the One Road, One Belt project, this is.Part of our comprehensive counter-terrorism project.
但是在这个过程中，大家也看到了南海问题、东海问题又都出来了。
But in this process, that we can see we have been facing some problems and challenges, like South China disputes.
所以我们这个综合反恐计划肯定是受到影响的。
会受到
影响，肯定会受到影响。
These challenges would certainly affect our comprehensive counter-terrorism project.
我们这个一带一路包括两条线，一是古代丝绸之路，就是贯穿到中亚国家一直到荷兰、欧洲，是吧？还有一条线就是中国南海嘛。
One road, one belt, including two direction. One is
从南太平洋。
OK，
这一就是海上丝绸之路和丝绸之路经济带，这叫"一带一路"嘛。所以大家现在看到，就是我们这两条线现在都面临着问题。丝绸之路经济带建设的过程当中，我们看到阿富汗、叙利亚现在正在处于动荡之中。
So we can see some problem happens.Like in Afghanistan and Syria, the civil wars is a big issue there.
我们在建设海上丝绸之路的时候，我们又看到南海问题又凸显出来了。
And we also see the South China Sea disputes.
所以，无论是北约也好，还有是东亚地区的这个军事同盟也好，肯定对我们上海合作组织的下一步反恐会产生很大的影响。
So NATO and some South.East Asia countries are very wary of our counter-terrorism project.
Okay.
So it's too early to judge success.
所以现在还不能够来判定你们现在的计划到底成功了没有吗？
这个是一个长期的过程。你现在，但是我们有决心是让它成功的。中国这么大。这个一带一路建设现在有这么多国家，一百来个国家来加入，现在有六十多个国家吧，亚投行哈。这个如果这个建设不成功啊，我们这个国家就是开了一个国际玩笑一样，中国开不起这种玩笑的。
Oh, this is a long process, and yeah.
I think Dr. Lee may have an answer to your question that you posed.
Matt 教授刚才这个评论，我觉得比我发言还好。 但是有很多观点他我是赞同的。你比方说就是说这个中亚国家是不是独裁者的俱乐部哈，这个原来我也是这么认为，这个毫无隐晦，他就是从那个计划经济体制，苏联那个冷战那个体制过来的，是吧？包括中国也在内，他这五千年这个封建文化，你想让他一下就达到你们这个民主啊，这个他可能还接受不了，很可能更乱。
You just ask whether or not the SEO is a club for the dictators of the region. And yes, I can't deny it. Yeah, because those countries just transformed themselves from a dictatorship country. Yeah.
What he said is, in the beginning, he thought the same way. That's
right. 所以如果是现在你们要是看这么看待这个中亚国家这个合作这个关系啊，我一方面是没有意见，再一个呢也是无奈，也是没有办法，我们这是历史决定的，历史这个或者各国国情决定。
Because this is part of the history, yeah.
各国人民也都是接受这种体制。
There's not too much we can do.
你要说是他是这个自由啊或者什么，你看看这些国家都乱成一套了，那谁我们国家是承受不起的，13亿人那么乱肯定是不行的。
你说自由就是民主，
对对对，民主自由就像西方那些
如果放在中国的话，
对，那肯定的是不行的。
Just like you know the Western style democracy can't we cannot practice the Western democracy in China.
我敢说，就是这些国家的人都向往自由，没有不向往。这自由是好东西，谁都知道。
I think everybody in those regions like freedom and democracy.
关键就是这个过程啊。还有呢，就是中国这个中国经营这个对这个上海合作组织这个支持，是不是我们要营造一个后院哈？
Okay, you also mentioned the reason China helped establish SCO is just, you know, just like we see the Central Asia is the backyard of China. Yeah, this is your question.
这个我毫不隐晦，我们就是要稳定那里。
Yes, we want to secure that region.Safe and secure.
中国不单在中亚要营造后院，包括我们所有的周边国家，我们实际上都在努力营造一个稳定的周边安全环境。
Not only Central Asian region, in other places, yeah, we also want to create a safe environment.
但是考虑到东亚和东南亚这个现实历史的问题啊，现实的问题啊，民族的问题啊，我们想把中亚建设一个模板。建立一个就是一个样板，给大家看看新型的合作关系，新型的国际关系是什么样的。
And we want to use Central Asia as a model to let the people in our region see.
我看看啊，关于中俄有这个不同的观点的问题哈，我也承认，肯定是有的。
那个恐怖的定义。
恐怖定义，昨天那个我看这个梅老师他们都已经都讲了，我们那个国家安全法都已经明确的有个明确的定义了，三点是吧？这个可以在网上都可以查。
你说你意思就是说那个对于恐怖的那个恐怖主义的定义跟外国是不一样的，是正你认为是？
不一样，只是在这个措辞上不太一样，但是实际上理念呢，还有这个性质的判断是一样的。昨天我们已经针对这个问题研究过，是吧？就跟这个讨这个发言的时候已经有这方面的讨论了。
Regarding the definition of terrorism, you wonder maybe our definition is different. Yeah,
that was my question.
你比方说采取极端手段那个对平，什么问题？
那就是说关于恐怖主义的定义。
哦，
对
对对对，这恐怖主义定义昨天是不是提出来了？是吧？
Regarding the definition of terrorism, right? Yeah, you have this question?
So yeah. I was making a comment that there's already been a discussion about that there is no single definition. And so I think in terms of the international community, we need to move towards getting a single definition. And that was something that Sean had raised in his paper. It's been a current.
关于这个恐怖主义的这个定义啊，就目前为止还没有一个那个一致性。那很明显的就是说我们已经渐渐的有这个共识。对对对对对，是的是的是的，是这样的。还有一个问题，我感到很就是说俄罗斯和中国在参加这个上海合作的这个组织这个自己的想法啊，您刚才说就是俄罗斯要把它变成是不是 NATO 是吧？
北约是吧？完了，中国呢是强调能源，对，是吧？能源哈，这个我这个这点我不太赞同。
You say that maybe Russia want to use you know the SCO as Asian matter, and but China want to use the what is that Central Asia as a resource.
因为就是在这个上海五国机制的时候，我们就充分的讨论了这个问题。这个俄罗斯和中亚国家，包括中国在内，都非常讨厌这个冷战体制。
I can't agree with you because both Russia and Central Asia and China, we all of us don't like the what is that the Cold War mentality.
大家都是那个很害怕回到那个时代。
That we are doing our best to avoid Cold War revival.
如果俄罗斯要把上海合作组织变成 NATO, 那就回到冷战。If
SCO become an Asian version of NATO, then we have go back to the what
is that? 另外，中国的考虑有没有能源方面的考虑呢？能源是绝对是有，但是只是一方面。
Regarding natural resources, yes, that is one of our considerations.
在这个非传统安全领域啊，能源、环境啊，那个毒品呐、啊，还有这个地质灾害啊，被灾，这个合作领域太多了，能源只是一部分。Our
consideration is very comprehensive, including resources, environment, everything. Yeah, and resources just one of them.
就包括俄罗斯在内，如果我们要不没有能源合作啊，它现在可能经济情况更糟糕。
If we don't cooperate in the energy and natural resources, then the situation of Russia would be much worse.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for the presentations. I have very simple three questions. Number one, do you have to write it down or to translate? Yeah. SCO, you said it's some regional security organizations. So, are you fighting or targeting only Uyghurs in Xinjiang or in Central Asia? Or the organization is also dealing with other Central Asian militant groups? If you do, can you provide any example? That's the first question.
Oh, sorry, can you repeat?
Yes, I can't hear properly. Shanghai cooperation organizations only fighting or targeting Uyghurs or Uyghur militants in Xinjiang or in Central Asia, or are they dealing with the other Central Asian militant groups in Central Asia?
关于这个 SCO 啊，它所针对这个反恐的工作，它只针对那个中亚部分的这个恐怖分子，还是说那个新疆部分的新疆的恐怖分子？
包括新疆在内的中亚国家，就是上海合作组织区域。
Yeah, I also ask like if you do, can you provide any examples? That's part of the question.
对，你可不可以提供任何的一个例子，就是说你们对付恐怖分子？我们对付这个打击恐怖这个实力啊，是在这个上海合作组织之内，它是提供一个框架。 但是具体的措施还是在自己本国之内。如果涉及跨国的话，我们通过这个联合军演呢、提供这个反恐这个信息情报啊、资料啊，这个方面合作就是几乎每天都在进行。The
SCO just provide a framework to deter terrorism, and we have some joint exercise against terrorism. Yeah, but the thing is, regarding the terrorists in other countries, yeah, they have to deal. I mean, they have to deal with
the terrorism. But
so you don't actually have any examples to provide, like you actually did prevent the other military militant groups in Central Asia. We just.
As a scholar, I can't give you some example.
My second.
Adam, we're going to have to move on, I think, because we've got another question, because we've only got 2 minutes left. So I just want to allow for the other.
Let me ask the last one.
Okay. Very quick. Make it quick.
Yeah. He said the religion in East Turkestan or in Xinjiang is different and you didn't translate. So I asked him, like, what does it mean different? Like, there is different sections of the Islam in East Turkestan because CCP trained new generation of religious leaders in Iran and came back, and they have two different views of Islam in East Turkestan, or it's different to the rest of Islamic world.
我知道了，我想起来了，这个问题我是这样，我们作为一个学者，他是从这个伊斯兰教这个发展的历史，有些时候，我们因为我们不研究伊斯兰教这个发展历史，那么新疆那个极端主义啊，他就散布一些这个宗教发展什么圣战的理念。 所以我们要想这个从这个群众这个角度，新疆民众这个角度，我们要告诉他，要告诉他我们也不能随便告诉，我们得深入研究。这新疆伊斯兰教到底是怎么来的？是怎么？刚才我还跟中国还跟这个戴维，我们还研究，还跟还有那个郭女士，我们都在研究这个伊斯兰教这个土，包括土耳其到新疆这个伊斯兰教的发展历史，大家观念是一样的，是吧？
Maybe we can continue that discussion in the break. I'm mindful that there's one question, and then we will have to wrap this up.
Yeah, I'd just like to move back to that counter-terrorism question and the SCI. So I am aware of some modest improvement in counter-terrorism liaison within the SCI, so I congratulate the SCO on that within the member states. Just one question I do have in the majority of the I suppose in the majority of the world, it's normally law enforcement or police that lead counterterrorism. I was just wondering, with the SCO, what role or what cooperation do police take within the member states?
The role of what?
The role of police.
Yeah.
Within the SCO and regards to counterterrorism.
Oh, 警察在...
Well, first I should ask, is there a role or is it military driven? And if police do have a role, what is that role?
在这个 SCO 反恐的这个工作里面的警察到底扮演什么角色，还是只是军队的工作？这个两方面，我们这个我刚才讲了，上海合作组织成立以来呢，一共举行了13次这个大规模的军事演习，其中有11次是军队系统的。 那么有两次是公安系统的，军队几次？11次，11次军队系统。他的这个名字叫和平使命，公安系统的叫天山演习，天山反恐演习。Since the
birth of SCO, that we had 13 joint action, to joint exercise, and 11, two of them. Were actually conducted by police force.
军队系统那个和平使命演习是2年一次，那么公安系统的是4年。两件什么？两年一次。
公安系统是两年。
公安系统五四年。
四年一次。
那个军队系统呢是两年，两年一次。
Every 4 years, the police force in China, they participate the, what is that, the joint exercise every 4 years. And regarding the armies, every 2 years.
所以公安系统现在有天山一号和天山二号两次演习。
所以已经举行了两次。
已经举行了。
So the police force have participated in the joint exercise twice.
反这个他们演习反恐的目标大家都是一样的，但是呢方式和这个基础是不一样的，因为公安系统它是来自于民间，就是这个更深入群众一些，那部队呢他平时住在军营，那是他是主要是针对这个大规模的这个恐怖啊，对极端组织啊，但是公安系统呢它更细致一些，所以这两个演习名称是不一样的。
The targets are the same, but the method different.
So we started 5 minutes early. We're ending 5 minutes late. So thank you very much, Dr. Liu, for your talk. And also thank you to Andrew for your, to Matthew for your very good discussant paper. So thank you very much. Thank you.